I have access.
Well, good evening, everyone. Welcome to the April 2022 meeting of the Denver Area Access User Group. And today we have kind of the special presentation of some work that's going on to modernize and improve the venerable old Northwind traders template/sample application that many of you are familiar with. You get to it by saying new database in Access, and then it's one of the templates in there that you can pick, and it's a full sample application. Probably the last time it had a major update was maybe 2006, based on the dates in it. But Access MVP Tom Van Stiphout is leading a group of earnest Access developers who are trying to modernize it, and he's going to present what is going on with Northwind, and hopefully get your feedback on any thoughts, ideas, preferences that you might have. So Tom, welcome, and thank you for joining us at the Denver Area Access User Group this evening.
Well, thank you, George, for the opportunity to speak about a topic that indeed has been, you know, with me for a long time. I started with Access 1.1. It didn't have Northwind then, but it came around soon enough, and it was always used by people as a, you know, one of those sample applications that people would look at to, you know, look at, hey, this is what Microsoft did, and we should do the same, or look at what cool things they introduced to us. And as I became a stronger developer and talked to more people, became part of the Access community, you know, it was clear that I'm not the only one who thinks that it leaves a lot to be desired. And in a few minutes, I'd like to go through Northwind, a couple of passes to show some of the things that I think we can improve on. And so this idea has been coined with Microsoft from time to time. You may or may not know that, you know, leadership in the Access team changes from time to time. People move on, people move up. Whenever there was a new chief, you know, we would broach this topic again. And with the last one, he said yes. So it was like, okay, this is great. And I had just actually written some code, and I talked in another group with Maria Barnes about it, where I took Northwind and upgraded it, what I call to convention. You know, there's a programming convention we like to use. Not everyone agrees on all the finer points, but, you know, the fact that we should not have spaces in object names is widely accepted. And so I wrote a bunch of code to make Northwind 1.1, if you will. But this effort is completely new. We want to start from scratch. We got a couple of people together, including Crystal Long, George Hepworth, George Young, and myself. And there's now at least four more hangers-on, people who are willing to also provide assistance with this effort. And this is kind of a status update of where the project is right now. By way of introduction, I already said that I've been working with Access for a long time. I've been MVP for a long time. My day job is with a small software development company in Phoenix, Arizona, where I write software with .NET and with Office Access, mostly. I also manage the team of software developers, but I write code at least 20 hours a week. And that's probably the part I like the most. Anyway, as we started talking about what would Northwind 2.0 look like, we realized that one of the questions we asked is, what's your audience? and the audience is very broad. There are developers who would like to look at that and say, oh, that's a cool trick. Maybe I can use that. But there's also absolute beginners who have little ideas to what access is or can be, and are trying to figure out if it's something that they could use for themselves. Maybe they're working with Excel or what have you, and they have a curiosity. And so we thought it would be very difficult to do what Northwind 1 tried to do, which is, you know, help everyone, and by that helping nobody, or not as well as I think it can be if we split it into two applications. So there will be a Northwind, right now the working title is a starter version for beginners, and a dev version that is more like the current Northwind, but has more in-depth features, some definitely some new features as well for interest to developers. And very importantly also, especially when you're completely new at it and you crack it open for the first time, it's like, what am I supposed to do? When you look at the user interface and you get to the home screen, what am I supposed to do here? Because really not much guidance, but also if you open the forms, or if you are just interested in kind of what was the design philosophy, what are we trying to do here? What kind of company is this? Very little documentation exists, and we definitely want to do a much, much better job with that. So there will be a whole set of web pages that will accompany Northwind 2.0, as well as, you know, in-app guidance. We started in about January, and we spent a lot of time in the beginning trying to get our bearing, trying to get a feeling for what the various members of the group felt was important. Spend a little bit of time on database design. And you might think, well, isn't that a little early? You haven't even decided what features you want. And to some extent, yes, but to some extent, looking at the database design again allows you to ask some new questions, to experiment with some new ideas. And so we kind of let that go for a little bit. We're now much more focused. We have gone through the initial stage of kind of thrashing around, trying to get a feeling for where we want to take it. So we think that the starter version will not be Northwind as we currently know it. It will have enough of the tables that you recognize of, oh, we have customers, we have employees, we have orders and products. You will recognize that, and it will all work better than it currently does. But somehow magically, there's always inventory. We never have to buy any inventory, it just is. We just sell. So obviously this is not a realistic company. It was never meant to be. And we will make that very clear. It's really about showcasing features. And since 2006, there's definitely been some new features that have been added to Access, and we want to show off some of those as well. As well as talk to these beginner developers and say, we're showing you this, but there are other ways. Once you get a little bit better up speed, you get a little bit deeper into the tools, there are other ways, and maybe the dev version will show you some of those ways, you know? And in the dev version, you know, we'll be much expanded, will be a much better database design. We've had enough discussion that we kind of know where we want to go with the database design. We will change customers to companies. It's more than just renaming it, because the current customers actually have contacts in them. The shippers and the vendors will become companies, just like our customers will be companies. There will be a company type, and we will have a separate contacts table. We think that's just a better way to organize the data. Tables have more of a, you know, a single purpose rather than multiple. But again, this is not meant to run any business. And I want to pause at that point for a moment, because there was one member in the group who felt that this new Northwind should be actually able to run a business. And we went back and forth over a couple of weeks on that topic. And at the end of the day, we really couldn't reconcile the disparate ideas. And that member has left the group on good terms. We didn't try to, you know, make any problems, but we did feel, and I felt, that at some point we need to coalesce around the idea and compromise and pick up speed and move forward. And so we're at that point now. So this will not run any business. We will make that very clear. But it will be a better Northwind, still showcasing features, but including features that developers will like as well. We'll rip out the existing inventory because it's frankly hard to understand how it even works, and it is redundant in some ways. We'll take the version that Alan Brown has with a single stock table and go from there. We're still looking at streamlining the workflows. You'll see in the demo that there are a couple of hiccups when you try to do order entry. We'll have much better error handling and logging. Really, we're trying to do best practice stuff a lot. We will get rid of some of the existing code that I'll show you in a few minutes. That is just hard to understand why to do this. If you're a beginner, intermediate developer, is this the first code that you want to learn from Microsoft? How you can wrap a record set object? Probably not. We will use the ribbon in the dev version. We'll have cascading dropdowns and a few other features. We have a timeline, of course. We're here now presenting externally, April 2022. So we are, you know, finishing up our specs. You'll see a little bit of it. And talking to groups like yourselves to get feedback. See if there's ideas there that we can incorporate into our thinking. And then the next step will be to work on the database design and finalize it. We are, I believe, better than 80% done with that. There's still a little bit to do. And as soon as that's done, then especially also these, I call them hangers on, that's maybe not the nicest word. The other contributors that have expressed an interest can also help with certain parts of the implementation and testing and so on. And we're hoping to be code complete in November. And then at that point, Microsoft has a process to go through. So we're actually going to deliver our first version, probably the code complete version, in November to Microsoft so that they can vet the code and look for any objectionable items that need to be changed. They are very picky about copyright and that kind of stuff. The images we will be using are coming straight from Microsoft. The company names we will be using, the person names, they're all on the approved list. And then we're hoping that, you know, December, I don't know, give or take, that we will have a Northwind 2.0 ready for download for you. The target development platform is going to be, the version is going to be 2019, not 2016, although I believe it will run. But 2019 is what we will be developing on. So that and 365 is kind of our target version. Let me skip this for now. I want to, since this is a programming group, I want to show some code and say that we're going to do the Northwind 2 application. Of course, this is Northwind 1. There is no Northwind 2 code today. I want to show you some of the things, because maybe some people will say, well, what's wrong about Northwind? Well, I'm about to show you. These are some of the things that we don't like about Northwind. The login experience is fine. A dashboard of some kind is fine. The fact that the bottom half is empty is because the data is from 2006, and this is supposed to show current activity. So in a moment, we'll create an order, and it will show up here at the bottom. There is some navigation going on here on the right-hand side. This is your main navigation, essentially, if you want to, you know, create a purchase order or enter a new supplier or whatever, you do that here on the right-hand side. A few of the main buttons are here in the top row as well. Give me a new order, give me a new purchase order, as well as some of the, you know, active orders from 2006, as you can see, as well as some for purchasing, some reorder stuff. I don't have a real problem with this interface. It looks a little dated. I told one of our designers, who Gina Whip, who is looking at changing the design, is that it should definitely be a different color. You know, even if the layout is somewhat the same, it shouldn't be this orange. You should be able to recognize it as new, and hopefully a little cleaner and newer. Let's create a new order. So we can, in this case, you can type a new customer, or you can select one. The idea is that we have a customer on the phone. This customer was set up, they don't have an email address, but that's fine. And then here we can enter products. So they wanna buy some elements, 10 of those. And so this is one of those things that we don't really like. You have a customer on the phone, now you're asked to create the purchase order. It's like, that's the last thing I want to do. I just want to enter my order, and someone in purchasing will see that the inventory levels are kind of low and that we just sold more of this. So get on that and on the double, get some more of that, those elements in. The fact that the order entry person would hear, okay, you can click no. And I don't have time to go through all the branches. I'm just going to click yes. And so here you are then, you know, in the purchase order, where you're going to send this to your vendor and say, give me some more elements because I'm selling them like hotcakes. Not enough information on this screen. For example, you don't know what the minimum inventory level is that we have set for this product. It doesn't show you anywhere. So there's so many problems with this this screen. If we know that we're about to sell some beer that was also low, then we can add that to it, and then we can submit for approval. This is another problem I have, is why do we have light gray on medium gray text here? That's impossible to read. It says submit for approval and it's disabled. The reason is that I'm someone who's able to approve my own purchase orders on a permissions basis. If I was logged in as someone else, then maybe not. So I can actually approve this. And hopefully the shipment will come in tomorrow. So this was kind of a diversion from my order. Oh, this is another problem I have with it, is it's not discoverable how you can reopen that order. You can maybe try to double click the record selector, nothing happens. Maybe you guess that you can click on the number. If it was hyperlinked, it would be so much nicer. You can get back into your order. I had accidentally closed this order, so sorry about that. If this is it, the status is on order, that's really nice. So you can tell the customer it's gonna come soon. You can try to create an invoice. This is good. There's a business rule that says no shipping. Then we can do that. So let's enter the shipping information. I'm going to ship it tomorrow for 23 or something. It's going to cost $15. And can we now create an invoice? No, because inventory has not been allocated for each specified product. So it's like, because this is still on order, we can't actually invoice now. But we'll tell the customer, thank you for your order, we'll send the invoice tomorrow. And the status did not refresh. If I do a shift of 9, does not refresh. The order is still in a new status. I find that a little not great. We can look at our purchase orders for a moment. See if we see our order. And no, we don't. Shift 9. Oh, sorry, here it is. A little bit different order. Here's the date. So it's approved status. We can again double click the number and kick it in the next bucket. So let's say that we are receiving now. So truck pulls up at the dock. Today is 4/21. This is good. So what it's trying to do here is going to say, hey, we have 100 that just came in. We also have some orders that need elements. So we're now going to go back into those orders and kick them into the next status because they're no longer on order. So that's good. Oh, that's what's happening here. Do you want to fill them now? Yes. Number 82 has been filled. This checkbox add to inventory doesn't make any sense to me because it seems like what are my options? I either leave the product in the truck and say, no, I don't want it, or am I going to receive it? And then of course, as I receive it, it's going to be added to inventory. Yes, yes, okay, fine. Cancel purchase, close. The one thing that can still happen here is kind of an optional step. I can say, well, you know, it's the end of the week, and so I've sent a check on 4/22 to pay for this order. As we see, the order status is approved. Shift F9 to refresh. It remains approved. I believe that that's wrong. It should not be closed. But once it's paid. So there are certainly bugs or discussion items in Northwind. If we take a minute to look at Alt-F11, take a minute to look at the source code, we can see that we have a couple of class modules and a couple of, you know, a little bit of everything. This is one of those, I call them wrapper classes. Actually, they call them wrapper classes. So so rather than calling open record set directly, right, which you would normally do, you would create an object of this type and then call its open record set method. And then you can see here what it does. It's basically you pass in the elements of a where clause, some criteria, some order by, and it composes a SQL statement and then calls the quote unquote normal open record set. And then it returns true or false, true for it all happened and false for we took an error. So a little bit debatable, I think, if this is a good idea, if this is something that you want to introduce to beginner to intermediate software developers. I wouldn't myself. I think this is too much. This is not really necessary. There are other things that you can show in code that would be, I think, more interesting. They do the same thing with the domain aggregate functions. You know, so it's like, don't call VLOOKUP yourself, call domain function wrapper with a dloop wrapper argument and a couple of arguments, and we will compose that. And you see how thin of a wrapper this is. There's really nothing here. You know, we just call it on your behalf. We're not even returning true or false for success or failure. We're returning a variant, which we can have to, because we might dloop up a string or an integer, right? So it has to be a variant that's going to be returned. But you can see how thin this is. Yes, there's a little bit of an error handler. This is also kind of strange, you know. You log an error and then resume. Resume presumably to the location where the error was triggered. Without further explanation as to why this is a good idea, I'm really not sure about it. And there are many examples of this throughout the code. As you probably know, by the way, Northwind is a combination of macros and VBA code. We intend, at least with the starting edition, to do the same thing, because again, it's a showcase, so we should probably do both. In the dev edition, I'm thinking that it should be VBA only. So, you know, there's nothing really wrong with a message box only function, but you know, is that worthy of a wrapper function in a showcase like this? I'm not sure. I really don't think so. I do like the string class that they have. It's not a class. It's a few functions where you can look up a string by number and say this is the string that I want and go into your strings table. This objects, so I can find things quicker. Strings. No, that's not a bad idea. If you want to translate this to French, then at least for the messages, that would be pretty quick. Of course, the UI would still be in English. But that's maybe a nice touch. I think that would be good to have that at least in the dev version. So that gives you a little bit of an idea of Northwind by way of refresher. Let's see how we're doing on time. I think we're okay. I want to take a few minutes to show you this. This is how the sausage is made, at least for this particular project, right? We're collaborating with a number of people to get to essentially the scope of work. So here we have two tabs, one for the dev version, one for the startup version. And this is the list of features that we were thinking of showing. Since you guys are developers, let's just focus on this one. This column shows whether the item is an enhancement over Northwind 1 or is essentially the same. So for example, the login form, we don't have a real problem with it. So we're probably going to keep it the same as it is. But we do think that the auto exec macro needs to change. And so we think that's an improvement. We think this is going to be a neat feature that if you download Northwind 2 in 2025, you shouldn't have all 2022 dates for all the orders. So we're going to write some code to lift up the dates to the current range. So anytime that you start the application, that you have kind of fresh test data, so that, for example, that bottom of the home screen, that it will actually show something. Or if you run a report and you think, you know, I wonder what year I should choose, that you can just use today's year. And it will always show you some data. I'm not going to go to every point, but this is how we made a list and try to get consensus amongst the group of, you know, what do you guys feel? Is this important? It's a one. If it's not important, it's a five. And so then, you know, some things get struck because as we discuss it, we say, hey, the login form is not going to have a password. Our reason was, you know, access is not secure in the first place. So why are we asking for a password? Just identify yourself by name. It should be good enough in most cases. If you have a SQL backend, we can talk more about security. There would be another presentation at some point. So, you know, all the things that we can think of, one of the very most important ones is a good data structure. I'm going to take a minute to show you. New things like the gallery is new in Access. If you think of 2006 version, 2003, that would have been, there was no gallery. There is one now. There were no temp files. There was no theming, at least not in this way. And so those are all going to be new features that we're going to use somewhere. There was no ribbon. There was no, oh, Northwind doesn't have an MRU list, most recently used. So it would be nice if there was a list that says, okay, the last 10 things you opened was these 5 orders and these 3 purchase orders and these 2 companies. So you can quickly jump back to that, because people often go back to things they were working on before. For example, now the order has been fulfilled, I can go back to that order that I created and create the invoice. Would be nice maybe if the order was in the MRU list. Yep. Again, as in current Northwind, we want a hyperlink so that we can discover. Now, there's a number of things. Bigger things are like modern chart. We want other design features. Maybe I'll point out some when we get there. We want to redo inventory completely. I think inventory was done. It can probably be defended, but it is not the best way it was done. And so we're going to use Alan Brown's way. I think it's much cleaner, much easier to understand, much easier to explain. Frankly, Alan did a nice job explaining it in his web page. So we'll probably borrow from that. Let's see what else is, you know, some other things are just find the way they are. We need to collect shipping information. We need to collect payment information. There's really not much we can do with that. There's a few things. One that's kind of interesting that, so the order form that you just saw me fill out an order, it's technically called the order details form. I don't think it should be modal, and you should be able to open more than one. So that would be nice that, you can have more than one open at the same time. We will not prompt to create a PO. Quantity is currently a single, or maybe it's a decimal. I don't remember, but it's not an integer. But we can't really sell 1.5 boxes of something, and so quantity should be an integer. So, you know, it's just a big list, and this list will be part of our scope of work and will then be, you know, part of the assignments to the developers and say, you're going to be, you know, doing the employee form, and these are the things that we want in there. So we want you to spend a few hours thinking about that, come back to the group and say, this is what I'm thinking. Do you have any questions? And then go to town with your V1 and be prepared to, you know, show your work to others and get some feedback and, you know, get to the next version and then maybe done. So that's how I'm kind of thinking of handing it out. We're going to have a self join, so we'll have a supervisor feed. So there's all kinds of new things. I think there will be a lot of things that developers will look at and say, oh, that's kind of cool. Maybe I can use that in my application, or at least I have an example here of something that I might want to do myself. Cascading dropdowns is another example. So just looking real quick, since you guys are all developers, at the data model. Sorry, I would have had it open if I had been home just a moment earlier. No, this is for the dev edition. And this is still being discussed. Like I said in the introduction, it's probably 80% there. A few things that perhaps jump out right away is correct naming convention without spaces or other funny characters. The stocktake table from Alan Brown that I've talked about, it's really so simple. It's really a nice way to do inventory tracking. In the current product table, there is a category name field. So we spun that off into a proper relational model. I believe the same thing happens with, not visible on this screen. Oh, here it is, product vendors. Product vendors is product suppliers, or suppliers, I believe is what it's called. Suppliers in the current product table is an MVF field. And since we don't do MVF fields in the dev edition, unless it is for a very specific reason that we want to make a point, we will use a proper relational model to model that. There are no more customers, there's companies with their company types. As I mentioned before, we will have vendors and suppliers. Sorry, that's the same thing. Shippers and customers in there. Employees are still their own thing. You could think of, maybe Northwind is a company and the employees are their contacts, but we didn't really want to go there. That's maybe one step too far. So we still have an employee table and we have a self-join because I wanted to show that. So we have a supervisor ID. Oh, and here is where we are indeed using an attachment field, not an MVF, but an attachment field to store the images of the employees. So we decided that since they were easier to get than the images for products, because that was another one, it would be cool to show products on the screen. It's just a little harder to do with copyright and whatnot. But images we have and names we have. So we'll use that. Some other things are really just about the same as before. Still a little bit of discussion if we continue to use tags. Frankly, I don't remember if we have finished that discussion or not. We still have privileges, just like Northwind 1. This is why the vice president can approve a purchase order, but a average salesperson cannot. Here's our MRU list. So you can see that it's coming together. It's not really that much discussion to be had about this anymore, I don't think. And then the other one, I believe it was in my six table model, yeah. This is for the starter edition, much simpler. Really take out everything that you don't absolutely need in order to make the point about, some features of access that, can show you what it can do. One new feature, because we wanted to use an MVF, is product likes. So we will have product likes where you can say, well, this company likes these three products. Check, check, check. And if this survives in the dev edition, it would be a proper many-to-many relation. So you can see orders, products, but it's otherwise very, very simple and no inventory, no purchase orders.
Tom, there are a couple of questions, comments, and chat. I don't know if you want to look at them or you want me to read them.
Yeah, this is a great time because I think this is kind of the overview of where we stand today. So I haven't looked at the chat yet myself, so this is probably a good time to do that. Or if you want to read them to me, then I will. Reactions, is that what it is? No. Sorry, I haven't used Zoom as much as some other people.
That's okay. I can go ahead and read them to you if you'd like.
Go ahead.
Okay, first comment or question, will you accommodate partial receipts of products? Suppose your supplier was able to send...
That's an excellent question. that goes towards that discussion that we had about should this be, what is Northwind? And actually we wrote up, I wrote up a paragraph and said, do you guys agree that this is Northwind? I used current Northwind as the starting point for that. And indeed in current Northwind, that is not there. And the discussion then became, if this is a fictitious company anyway, and if this is software that is not meant to run any business, and we don't want it to, we don't even want that responsibility, even if we felt that we could do it, we would probably say, well, first of all, you would want to pay me for it. It becomes a commercial product because, but anyway, so we got to the point where we said, we are not going to enhance Northwind with some features that some companies might want. Because indeed, some companies do partial shipments. Some companies do partial invoices. Some companies receive product and it's not the exact quantity that they ordered. All of those things, and probably a list of another 100 items, are all true for some companies. But that is not the function of Northwind. And so, no, we are not going to implement those kinds of features that might be of interest to some companies. That's really not the goal of this still showcase application, but at a higher level.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah, it's enough of a battle getting agreement on access features, much less what an inventory management system might look like. Huh? The second question from Tom is, what is the big advantage of the wrapper functions that you, I believe he's referring to the VBA that you showed a little bit ago?
I wish I knew. It's not clear to me. You saw that I gave a few examples. The wrappers are very thin, sometimes almost non-existent in the case of the domain aggregate functions. The record set function at least returns true or false. But you know, if you do a set RS equals currentdb.openRecordSet something bad, then it will either raise an error, which you will trap, or RS will be nothing, which you can test for, or you can test for, you know, EOF or whatever the exact situation is. So we already have plenty of ways. Do we really need that function to return true or false? I don't think so. And therefore, yeah, the question still is of what were you thinking? And there is not enough documentation to get into the mindset of the designers. And we want to do a much better job with our documentation, not just of saying this is how that feature works, but also at a higher level of these are the things we were thinking about. These are the concepts. This is the kind of company and the kind of project we had in mind, so that it's perhaps easier for people to understand what it is we're presenting to them. But certainly I would like to see a lot more inline comments. And I would also like to see some web pages that specifically go into it and say, if we will have, for example, we will certainly have error handling, better than this error handling that Northwind currently has. And there will certainly be a page about what is error handling, why is it a good idea, and why is this implementation a good implementation that you should perhaps want to follow. And perhaps also here's some links to other web pages. Other people have talked about error handling as well. So here's some videos and some pages that you can explore further, kind of curated by us in the team, as you know, these are valuable contributions that should probably be mentioned there as well. So that's where we want to go with this particular item.
Thank you. Next, a comment also from Tom. Please tell me that the table denormalization wizard will not be active in the dev version, referring to click to add new column.
Oh, yes. I think I know what you're referring to when a table is in design view. Or what view is it in? I know what you're talking about, where you can add,
scroll to the end of that table.
To the right?
Yes.
We are
maybe. I know I saw
it. Oh, and I have turned it off. So yes, here's where it would be next to the last column.
It wasn't off in one of the tables that you popped open. That's why I noticed.
Oh, okay. Yeah, definitely. There are a lot of things that I could, there's just too many to talk about today, but it bothers me to no end that when you first open the relationships window, there are some MSys tables showing as well.
Mm-hmm.
Like, where did they come from and why are they on this design?
I'm also not a fan of subdata sheets, but
yeah,
whatever.
Yeah, there's a number of things that that we want to try to follow best practices the way we understand them. And also, you know, a number of people will look at this, hopefully with attention to detail. And some people, like yourself, will have their pet peeves and I will have my own. And together, I think we will create a strong product that everyone can look at and say, that's pretty good. That is indeed how we write professional software. You know, even though it is a simple application and it's not meant to run a business, what is there should be of the highest quality that we can achieve.
Thank you, Tom. There was a concern about reserved words in tables, such as the word description used as a field name in the products table.
Uh-huh. That's not a reserved word. But
yes,
if there are reserved words, then we will indeed avoid them.
Yeah, go to Ellen Brown's website. You'll see it's a reserved word.
Hmm. Okay. I know that there are multiple lists floating around, and that perhaps some lists are perhaps not as current as they were at the time when they were published. But certainly, we will not have reserved words anywhere. With reserved words, I mostly mean the ones that really can cause notational difficulties. You know, you cannot not have a column named from, because that messes up your SQL statements where you have a from clause. So call it something like email from or whatever, address from. But I will specifically take note of description and see what the consensus is about that. Usually I use the object browser, you know, F2 in VBA. And if the word exists there, then I think it is, we should not use it, F2. So description. So here it does exist as a member of the error class. I'm not too concerned as a member of the error class, but not really as anything in like a property of a table dev or so. But okay, we'll definitely take a look at that. And if there are improvements to be made, we will certainly do that.
Thank you, Tom. Last comment from Dave. It says that the revised data model has a mix of singular and plural naming, both in table names and column names. I propose using singular as a standard.
Yes. So yes, I hear echoes of the first 3 months of our existence as a working group, because indeed from my left ear, I was hearing singular is great. From the right ear, I was hearing nope, plural is great. We settled on, we're not gonna change names of Northwind 1 unless there's a really good reason. So for the most part, we have left the names alone. Yes, we took out the spaces, but I mean, I might have called this order singular text status, but this is the way it was written. Orders status, that's kind of hard to pronounce for me. I would have called it order status. But because there is no one naming convention that everyone can agree on, the one that the group was grudgingly agreeing on was, let's leave the names alone because we can be here until November just discussing names, and that's just not worth it. So that's where we ended up. It's not the only way, and there's nothing wrong with someone saying, I really don't like this and I'm going to change it. If you do it manually, it's quite a bit of work. If you want to do it programmatically, you can find that presentation that I was hinting at earlier, where I took out the spaces. And it's not that much of a stretch to say, you know, I want singular, using that exact same code. And that code fixes up all the usage of it, you know, because these table names, of course, are used in queries, and the field names are used in control sources and in macros. And there's a little bit of work to do if you want to actually change it and be successful throughout. There's, of course, references to it in the VBA, so you would have to be able to parse the VBA. And if you look at my sample code, you'll see some light attempts to do that. That's a lot of work.
Thank you. That's all we have in the chat window. Tom, should I share the survey URL in case anybody wants to fill that out? Or
I think that's a great idea. I would also like to say, if we're getting towards the end of the time, that continue to think about this, and it's not difficult to find George or myself, and send us an email or reach out to us if you have ideas. If tomorrow or in the weekend you think about something and you want to bring it to our attention, certainly that would be very welcome. We will be discussing these plans with other groups. There is an MVP email list. Those people will get it very soon. There is a conference in Europe in a few weeks. I don't know exactly when. I'm speaking there as well. So many people will start to know about this, and we'll have an opportunity to download our functional spec document. I want to make it publicly available and provide comments. Oh, there's one thing I didn't show yet. Are we at the deadline, or do we have 5 minutes?
Oh, we've got about 20 minutes, so you can even open it up for general feedback, comments, or whatever you'd like to do, Tom.
I just wanted to show one more thing that I haven't gotten to at all, and that's kind of visual, so maybe fun to see. Some of the very early design ideas that our designer came up with, trying to get in the head of what is it that you want, and what is it that I want as a designer. This was an early idea of the switchboard page. There is a better version of it, this one, where we don't have as many different button sizes. Something a little fresher that would maybe be nice. This was another idea of a navigation, a left navigation, where the rectangle would be displaying whatever form this is. We don't really want to use the navigation form, the actual one that is in Access. It's one of the few features we think we can't really show very well. We have one idea, but whether that will fly or not, I don't know yet. But you know, just, you know, click on this button and change the source object of the subform. That's certainly something we could do. And so she is just having fun with this. This is one, again, very early also, is a help page. Something like this might be a floating page that's always on the screen, unless you close it, where you get some early information and some hyperlinks to guide you. Say, okay, why am I here? What can I do from here? So that is that. But yes, otherwise, and this is all very early, of course. We have not really discussed it in the group yet. It just came in the last few days. So speaking in general, you know, more feedback is great. We love to hear what your ideas are, what your features perhaps are. We have occasionally added features kind of late in the game and say, oh my goodness, we have never really thought about this feature. And I'm glad that we're now adding it to the list. So if there are things about access that you didn't hear me talk about or that you don't see in the document we will be sharing soon, definitely speak up and say, hey, I think this is also important. I use this a lot, or my customers like this a lot. That's all great, great feedback.
Tom, do you want to maybe mention some of the newer access features that have come in since 06 that you're thinking about including?
Yeah, so I mentioned a few of them. So we have the gallery. We have, of course, new data types, such as MPF. We have modern charts. We do have, that was already there, the summary line at the bottom. We want to use rich text. I don't think that's currently used anywhere. In Northwind, let's see, what other features? I mentioned the there's more programming features than access features. There's not that many more access features, I don't think, that are completely new. Split form. No, that was also there. Yep, I take that back. Split form was already there. And it's used in Northwind 1. I didn't realize it initially. Let's see if I can find it real quick. No, I've broken. Oh, this is the different version. Some of the list forms. Maybe. This one. No, maybe not that one. So split form is used in access, and I believe employees. Oh yeah, this is one of them. So here you have what appears to be a data sheet, but we still have a header and footer, or at least a header. And data sheets don't do that, but split forms do. Programming features, we have quite a few. I mentioned several of them already. The ability to open multiple forms of the same kind, removing modal, the ribbon, self-join, cascading dropdowns. I'm sure I'm missing several others. There are also minor things that we're doing. And then, as I alluded to when we went through the demo, there's Northwind features that we want to change, such as let's not pop up a sales order while we're just entering an order. We're also doing other minor things to modernize, like we don't really use fax numbers anymore, so we can remove that. Collect feedback via email was an access feature that has been removed. So of course we will remove those kinds of links. Add contact from Outlook. We don't really want to do that. We want to do show on map just because it's one line of code and it kind of looks cool. Pictures in the attachment fields, you saw that. And on the coding side, you know, just really more professional grade coding that I think people can look at and say, yes, I understand what it's doing here. I understand why this is here. I don't have to guess why we're doing these wrapper functions. If we're implementing a feature, we will document it so that it is clear why it is there. We won't always 100% agree, but I think we will agree for the majority of it.